I enjoyed all of that. That was wonderful. Praise the Lord. I like that old song y'all brought out there too. I remember that really. It's really been in my heart and mind for years. Amen. I want you to turn to Matthew's Gospel, chapter number 17. And that's on page 1022. 1022 in the old Scofield Bible. Matthew chapter number 17 and verse number 1. And after 6 days, Jesus taketh Peter, James, and John, his brother, and bringeth them up into a high mountain apart, and was transfigured before them, and his face did shine as the sun, and his raiment as white as the light. And behold, there appeared unto them Moses and Elijah, Elias is Elijah, talking with him. Then answered Peter and said unto Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. If thou wilt, let us make here 3 tabernacles, one for thee, and one for Moses, and one for Elijah. And while he yet spake, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and behold, a voice out of the cloud which said, This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased, hear ye him. And when the disciples heard it, they fell on their face and were sore afraid. And Jesus came and touched them and said, Arise and be not afraid. And when they had lifted up their eyes, they saw no man save Jesus only. I want to talk a little bit tonight about seeing Jesus only. Now, Christians have many friends to whom they can fellowship with, and we all have those, and it's good. It's really good to have someone you can fellowship with. Many of our friends are spiritual and dedicated to Christ, and it's easy to talk with them about the things of the Bible, and we enjoy that greatly because they have a spirit that we kind of hook up when we talk to people that are spiritual. Now, being associated with these kinds of people, these spiritual people, it causes us to want to live more holy ourselves. And humor is probably not a sin, a certain amount of it, but too much fun, in the pulpit especially, will leave a congregation dry. You can't feed my soul on jokes. Now, I mean, I like a little humor every now and then, and I can tell jokes, but there's a right place for that, and there's a wrong place for it. And I'm talking about clean joke, just fun. And I love fun. I'm not an old bogey, but I want to tell you something. When it comes to the pulpit, everything that comes out of this pulpit ought to be something spiritual. It ought to be the Holy Ghost directing us and letting us have a great time in the Lord. The more we talk about Jesus Christ, the better we feel. I mean, doesn't it? It feels good to get with people and talk about the Lord. Now, it doesn't feel that good if you don't talk about the Lord. And when we spend time fellowshipping with Jesus in a quiet place, it is more enjoyable when we come to a public place and begin to discuss Him. The transfigured glory was wonderful for Peter, James, and John here. And of course, when they saw Moses and Elijah appear in there, that really did something for them. Now, this was indeed a glorious experience, and the excitement was so great that Peter spoke up and said, Lord, it's good for us to be here. No doubt it was. And not many people ever experienced anything like that. But my friend, he said, let us make 3 tabernacles here. Let us make one for you, Lord, and one for Moses, and one for Elijah. And while Peter was speaking those words, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and behold, a voice, the voice of the Father, spoke out of the cloud and said, This is my beloved Son, hear ye him. Now the disciples fell on their faces, afraid. They were never experienced anything like this before, but it really scared them. And Jesus touched them and said, Arise and be not afraid. Boy, he's got the comforting word in every situation. When we get to a place to where we're afraid of anything, then Jesus seems to come along and comfort our hearts and assures us that everything's all right. I've got you in my hand. And so right here, when they had lifted up their eyes, they saw no man save Jesus only. Now, there are 3 experiences right here that I want to mention very briefly, and I'll let you go home. First of all, we do have a glorious sight. Verse 2, and was transfigured before them, and his face did shine as the sun, and his raiment was white as the light. Verse 3, and behold, there appeared unto them Moses and Elijah talking with him. Now these disciples, remember, were human beings that had a lot of knowledge about the things of God. And these disciples had heard much about Moses and Elijah in their lifetime, two of the greatest heroes of the Old Testament, Moses and Elijah. I mean, you name somebody in the Old Testament greater than Moses and Elijah, it'd take a long time to find somebody greater than these two heroes. They did great works for God. And this, my friend, the disciples knew about it. They knew what Moses had done. They knew what Elijah had done. They knew of the courage that Moses had when God told him to go down into the land of Egypt and face that powerful Pharaoh and look him in the face and say, I got a message from God that I want to tell you. Now, boy, that took courage, even though God's with you, to face a man that powerful and say, my God said, let my people go. Boy, that's plain. But that's what Moses did. He went under the direction and leadership of God and did exactly what God told him to do. Now, they knew of the contest that Moses had with the people of Egypt, those wise people and magicians and famous people there that worked for Pharaoh. But they also saw the superiority of God and the way Moses performed. Nobody could outdo Moses in the land of Egypt. There was never any doubt in their minds, I'm talking about James and Peter and John, about Moses being God's choice servant. They had that in their mind. They knew that was a great man. And here we are seeing Moses. My goodness, what an experience this is. And then they also knew of the mighty power that Elijah had been used by God in many, many occasions, that God used Elijah greatly to show forth his power and to let people know, I'm God. And one of the greatest is what we preached about the other night, whenever he challenged those prophets of Baal, 450 of them, and brought them up on Mount Carmel and had a contest and defeated them right there and then destroyed them. He destroyed every one of them. And my dear friend, I want you to know Elijah was a mighty man. And so these disciples knew about Elijah. One of the greatest demonstrations in the Bible is what he did on Mount Carmel. So there, these events involved in Moses and Elijah would be enough to excite anybody. As a matter of fact, not only had Peter, James, and John heard of these great men, now they're seeing them. And so no wonder Peter got excited. No wonder he opened his big mouth. He's got a big mouth. He had a big mouth. He spoke up many times when everybody else was silent. And he said, oh, it's good for us to be here. And it was. Nothing wrong with that. But he wanted to make three tabernacles, one for Jesus, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. But my friend, he didn't realize how far ahead of himself he was getting. So these are two characters that are really standout characters in the Bible. Matter of fact, every one of these two great men, Moses and Elijah, everybody in here has heard about them all in our lifetime. I mean, we've read about them. We've heard them preached on. We've seen them. Matter of fact, they're two top characters in a good fundamental Sunday school. Any good Sunday school that is really a Sunday school that's led by God, those teachers will sometime or another teach their children about Moses and Elijah. So these were two great men indeed. But remember, brother, they were not Jesus. They were not Jesus. Jesus Christ is greater than all of these. But a glorious sight indeed they saw. But then we have not only a glorious sight, but we have a great Savior. Verse number 5. This is my beloved Son. This is the voice of God the Father thundering out of that crowd that they were overshadowed by. And he said, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. Hear ye him. And my friend, when the cloud was gone away, they lifted up their eyes. Moses and Elijah were not there. Only Jesus. That's the only one standing there with them was the Lord Jesus Christ. Before Moses was, Jesus was. Before Elijah was, Jesus was. My friend, Jesus is greater than all the prophets, because none of those prophets, as good as they were, great as they were, could save one soul. Not a one. Moses and Elijah were both greatly used of God, and that's God's choice. God has chosen down through the years to use men. I mean, that's God's way. I didn't write it, I didn't make it up. But God uses men to reach other men and to do great feats for Him. And so He used Moses and Elijah. So they were not sent to Calvary, though. These two men, great as they were not sent to Calvary. They were not only begotten sons of God. Now, my friend, over in John 3:16, speaking of Jesus, the Bible says, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son." Jesus is the only begotten Son of God, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. I love to read about Moses, hear about Moses, Elijah, but hey, they can't give me eternal life. They did not go to Calvary for me. They did not die for me. They did not pay for one sin that I've ever committed. They couldn't wash a sin away. But boy, Jesus Christ could. Jesus Christ could. He did. Jesus Christ was the only one that could go to Calvary and take your sin and my sin completely away. Every sin. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me." We don't go to the Father through Moses or through Elijah. They're great men. We give them their due, but we can't go to God through them. We can't go to God even through the Virgin Mary. Now, you know, there are a lot of religionists tonight that believe they can go to God through Mary, the Virgin, but that's a lie. That's a religious lie that's been taught down through the ages. There's only one mediator between God and men, and His name is Jesus Christ. And that's what the Word of God says. You can't pray to a saint in heaven if they're there. You can't get a prayer through to a saint to save your life. You can't get a prayer through to Mary to save your life. Brother, the only way you can get to God through prayer is through the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's Jesus all the way. It's Jesus only. They saw only Jesus Christ. My friend, as great as they were, they could not save one soul. As great as Elijah was, he could not save one soul. Jesus Christ can save any soul. Woo, glory. Hallelujah. He not only can save a soul, He can save any soul. And that's how this old boy got in. Boy, you think I don't appreciate the Lord Jesus Christ? Brother Ron was talking to me in the prayer room a while ago about Scripture and the knowledge of the Scripture. And I said, "Ron, did you know I'm getting to the place where I'm forgetting things that are familiar and that have been familiar for years and years, and I'm forgetting them now? Sometimes I have to reach over and get my concordance and look it up because I can't remember what it said." And I'm telling you, I'm failing in a lot of ways. I see it. But oh, I thank God when the day comes, I'm going to be with my Savior. I'm glad nothing's going to ever take that away from me. I may fall down tonight on my face and die. I may do that. But brother, everything is okay. Don't you ever worry about me, honey. I'm telling you now. Don't worry about me. If I go home, because I know my Savior lives and I'll be with Him. Jesus Christ saves you. He saved me. And we're here tonight rejoicing in our salvation. We know sitting here upon these pews tonight that all the demons in this world cannot take our soul away. No, my friend. Jesus only was all that was needed for salvation. He's the only one needed for eternal salvation for the sins of the whole wide world. Jesus only is all we need for peace and joy. That's what we're enjoying tonight. Hallelujah. Peace in our soul flowing right now. Peace where we used to be disturbed, frustrated, and aggravated, and irritated, and couldn't get things straight to save our life. We tried everything we knew, but it never worked. But praise God and the Lamb forever, there's a peace, even in the midst of the storm. In the midst of all of this sickness, all of these things that happened to us, there's still that deep down peace. Jesus only is all we need for that. All we need for joy. Jesus only is all we need for power to overcome sin. I used to couldn't overcome sin to save my life. I wanted to. I promised myself I'm going to. I promised my mama I'm going to. I couldn't. I just couldn't. I'm just a sinner. I was wide open. I'd sin. Dirty, rotten, low down, good for nothing, fool. It's what I was. Hallelujah. But now, all of those things I participated in are gone, have been long gone, thank God, ever since Jesus came into my heart. My friend, Jesus only will come one day and take us home to be with Him. Nobody else. The Bible says Jesus Himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God. And the dead in Christ shall rise first. We which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with Him in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Jesus Himself is going to come and take us home at the rapture. Jesus only will be the one to judge us at the judgment seat of Christ. I won't judge you, and you won't judge me. We won't judge each other. Now here, in this life, we judge each other. We prejudge, we accuse each other. We accuse each other of things, we surmise. We have all kinds of judgments going against each other. But over there, friend, you won't open your mouth. You won't say, now, Sammy Kay, I know this. Now, you ain't shut your mouth. I'm judging. Jesus is the judge. He'll judge it correctly at the judgment seat of Christ for the believer. And then at the white throne, He'll be the judge there too for the lost sinner that's not going to be saved. So Jesus only is the judge. And then Jesus only can save any sinner right now. He can save a sinner. He can save any sinner. And He can save any sinner right now. There may be a sinner listening by streaming. Maybe somebody in this building. You're not saved. You've never been born again. He can save you right now. I was studying today. I'll probably preach on it sometime. Maybe Sunday, I don't know, about today. Today is the day of salvation. Now, there's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. Jesus only. Amen. Jesus only is that friend that sticketh closer than a brother and loveth the same at all times. No friend like Him is so high and holy. No, not one. Jesus only. There's not an hour that He's not near us. No, not one. Jesus only. And then, my friend, did ever a saint find his friend forsake him? No, not one. Not a saint of God who's ever lived found Jesus to forsake him. He's always there. Was ever a gift like the Savior given? No, not one. He's called the unspeakable gift of God. We've received all kinds of gifts from God's grace. Every good and every perfect gift cometh down from Him. But there's not a gift like this gift. Not a gift that can compare with the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus knows all about our struggles. Thank God, I'm glad He does. Because I have a lot of them, you have a lot of them, don't we? But He knows all about it. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. Then, my friend, not only do we have a glorious sight here, and a great Savior, but we have a gracious sensitivity. In verse number 9, as they came down from the mountain, Jesus charged them. And the Bible says, they, you know, of course, teaches us right here that they were very sensitive to the words of Jesus. They went up with Him on the mountain, and they're coming down with Him. They did not separate. They did not divide. Everything was working right on time. They went up together. They came down together. Now, the experience didn't make these disciples perfect, no, but it did not divide them. Peter didn't go one way and James go another. John go another. They didn't do that. They didn't say, well, I don't agree with that. Well, this is my opinion. They didn't get in those arguments. They went up. They came down. Very sensitive experience for these disciples. My friend, verse number 10, why then say the scribes that Elijah must first come? And Jesus gave them an answer in verse 13. Then the disciples understood that He spake of them, of John the Baptist. Now, this was a very sensitive moment, I said, in the lives of Peter, James, and John. Now, it's not sinful to ask questions about the Scriptures, but you must be willing to accept the answers the Scripture gives. Don't ask a question about the Bible and then argue about it. When God gives you the answer, take the answer and go with it. God's given you something to help you and bless you and help you in your life. You remember Jesus Christ had referred to John the Baptist as Elijah. Now the disciples received Christ's answer and they were satisfied because this was a sensitive time. It wasn't a divided time. It wasn't a problem time for any of them. Jesus did not right now call John the Baptist by name, but they understood everything he was saying. Now Jesus gave such a description of John the Baptist they could know. And when we are sensitive to the words of the Lord Jesus Christ, we rightly divide them. We rightly divide these Scriptures when we are really sensitive to the Scriptures. I mean, we get down to nitty gritty. Somebody said the other day they started reading the Bible slowly and just a small part and meditating on it. I said, that's the way you ought to do. It's all right to read through the Bible. We do that. We all do that, read through the Bible. But the thing about it is, every now and then you need to slow down, slow up, and start reading just a small portion, like for a devotion at night. Read just a few verses and meditate on them. Boy, you'll be surprised what God will give you, what God will bless you with. Ralph Mount years ago told me, put me onto this thing. He said, you know, many times I've been, and he was a deep man, one of the best on the tabernacle I ever saw. And he told me, he said, I get excited. And then I'm getting in the Scripture, and all of a sudden I run across something I don't understand. Maybe it sounds like a contradiction or whatever. And he said, I'll stay there and I'll pray and I'll see and I'll look and I'll pray and I'll see. And God gives it to me. And he said, boy, I'm so happy. I don't know what to do. I know I've been there. And he said, then I get excited and maybe a little bit too excited. I run ahead of God then. I go so ahead of him that I start missing some things. Then I got to slow down, come back to where God showed me and start again slowly. And let God finish off the revelation and the illumination that God gave me. And I started doing that. I wait on the Lord and see what God has. Meditation is important. That's the reason I like to come to work early and just sit and study and pray and meditate. Close my eyes sometime and let the Holy Spirit speak to my heart. Now, dead religion is insensitive to the things of Jesus Christ. The natural man understandeth not the things of the Spirit. The Pharisees, the Sadducees, the scribes, and the priests were always questioning Jesus with foolish questions. They were not interested in the truth. They just wanted to try to trap Jesus. You know that. They were trying to ask Jesus questions that were foolish. Now, when we believe Jesus only, we are right. We're right to believe Jesus only tonight. Now, let God be true and every man a liar. In Titus 3:9, the Bible says, avoid foolish questions and genealogies and contentions and strivings about the law, for they are unprofitable and vain. People ask, you know what? I'm going to close with this. I like to close on a mean note. I don't like to close on a good note. I want to close on a mean note. But you know, we've got members down through the years. We've had them. May have a few now. They come to church when they take a notion. They come to church maybe once a month, maybe twice a month, and then whenever church is over, they've always got a complaint, or they've got a suggestion, or they want to straighten me out on something, or they want to find fault with somebody. They just come once in a while, but when they come, boy, they've got all of this revelation. They know everybody. They know everything about everybody, and then they start in. Well, you know what? God said just avoid them old foolish questions. People don't ask sensible questions. They ask foolish questions. Ask something. And you know, some of them, they don't read the Bible. Never read. I mean, I know. I can tell. They don't ever read the Bible but once in a while. But every once in a while, they'll get a verse of Scripture out of the Old Testament with a name that's that long and you don't use frequently. And you know, you have to go back in your mind and say, well, I know I read it because I've read the Bible. But I'd have to go back and look that up because I'm not real sure who you're talking about. And then they want to ask you a question like, boy, I've been in the Scriptures and I'm so deep. I know all about these deep things in the Old Testament. I want to ask you a question. Boy, that question don't make a bit of sense. Don't make a bit of sense. And I said, I tell you what, let me have that name. I write it down. I go to my study. I'll let you have something next week. I'll let you have something Wednesday or Sunday, whatever it is. I'll get it for you. And boy, I do. And then I study a while on whatever that thing was that they were asking about. But they didn't a bit more care about whether I got them the truth or not. Whether they wanted to let me know I'm in the Bible. I'm a deep thinker, boy. I've got it down. I'm ahead of everybody. That's hypocrisy. Praise God, don't be a hypocrite. Be real. If you don't read but one scripture a whole week, meditate on that one scripture and get it down. Get it in your heart. And let God be true and just let every man be a lie. Avoid. Now, God said avoid foolish questions. I didn't say that. I read it right out of Titus 3:9. Avoid foolish questions. And people ask so many foolish questions. It just don't make sense why people get like that. But anyway, seeing Jesus only will help us all in a lot of ways. It's all right to study the Bible, study Moses, study Elijah, study David, study Paul, all of that. That's interesting. You got to, if you study the Bible, you got to study all of that. But don't let anybody take the place of Jesus Christ. Jesus is number one. He's the Savior. He's the Creator. He's God. He's you're my Creator. He's our Savior. He's our King. He's our everything. But nobody, that can't be said about anybody else in the Bible. I love them all, and I'm going to see them in heaven one day. And you think I'm not going to give Sister Mary, the Virgin Mary, a word of commendation if I have opportunity? I mean, I'm feeling like I will. I'm certainly planning to. I'm certainly planning to hug old Paul's neck and say, boy, you helped me a lot in your epistles that you follow God in. I'll have a good time, I believe, when I fellowship with Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, David, all that. I'm looking for heaven, y'all. But I'm going to tell you, most of all, I want to see the one that died for me. I want to be able to tell Jesus over and over and over again, I'm glad he didn't let me go to hell. How that whenever I was going straight to hell as I could go, but he turned me around, saved my old soul, and said, I've got you a place in heaven reserved. Man, I'm looking forward to that. So we have a glorious sight. We have a great Savior and a gracious sensitivity. And I'm telling you right now, Jesus only, it makes it all worthwhile. Let's stand to our feet, bow our heads. If you're here tonight or by streaming, you're not saved. I tell you, you need to be saved right now. You need to let Jesus come into your heart and be your Savior. Ask Him in. Ask Him to come in. Believe Him, and He'll save your soul as surely as I'm standing here. He will not lie. He cannot lie. And he said, him that cometh to me, I'll in no wise cast out. You come by faith, by simple childlike faith. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for your great plan of salvation. We thank you, Father, for the great Savior, your Son, your only begotten Son, the Lord Jesus. Lord, we thank you for all the Bible and all the good stories we have in the Bible. We thank you for all of these things, Father, but most of all, we are in love with Jesus Christ. We're in love with Him because He loved us enough to go to Calvary. Nobody else could have, nobody else would have, but He did. And I'm glad that salvation has been paid for by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I pray that if there's someone here lost, convict them, Father, of their sin. Help them to come to Christ before it's too late. And those by streaming, Father, speak to hearts out there and let people get saved by the grace of God. We'll give it all to Thee and ask that You do it, and then we'll give You the glory for what You do. Thank You, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.